What do you think? What message do you think are the perpetrators trying to send by actually detonating that bomb, that IED, one in the middle of a mass in Mindanao State University? What is the message? I mean, something that wasn't random, that was planned, it was intentional, a date was picked. What was the message?
Very deliberate yung attack. One, it targeted a religious gathering by a minority religion inside a majority community, Muslim majority community. And yung message is clear. One, they wanted to strike terror. Second, they wanted to choose a soft target kasi hindi naman siya military target na fortified. So, mas madali. Pangatlo ay they wanted to divide yung people in Mindanao and in the Bangsamoro between Christians and Muslims. Yung messaging na yun is very, very clear. So,
But then I wanted to ask you, the sowing division, wouldn't that be a little too late in the day at this point? Because the Mindanao State University is an open university. It's quite diverse as it is, right? It's quite sophisticated. So Mindanao State University, you have many students, professionals of different beliefs there, and that's been accepted for decades already, that Mindanao State University is that kind of place. What's even troublesome is the fact that you have the PNP, there's a PNP station just a few meters off Mindanao State University. So do you really believe it's about so still sowing divisions of faith?
I think that's still the message because in the past, nung wala pa yung violent extremism, wala namang messaging doon and na ganitong klase. And in the past, while there has been wars in Mindanao for a long time, it has never been a religious war. It was about the right to self-determination, a people want to defend themselves. But itong lately, itong pagpasok ng violent extremist, and you saw that in the 2017 siege of Marawi and even prior to that in Butig in 2016, merong talagang very subtle na messaging na for instance, the peace agreement does not work because it's not about religion and that there is no attempt to impose a strictly religious law in the Bangsamoro government. So talagang merong attempt to provide an alternative which is based on a misinterpretation of a religious text and say this is the alternative for us.
But is it that or because I've been to Marawi, I was there last year, and the rehabilitation is quite disappointing, right? If you go to Marawi, you have big buildings, auditoriums, coliseums, billions of pesos were spent, and all these buildings are empty because the residents, hundreds of thousands of residents of Marawi, are still living in shelters, container vans. They have no water or buying really expensive water, no jobs. So it's been 6 years, ganun pa rin ang sitwasyon ng mga residente ng Marawi. I've heard another expert say that people always don't want to find the connection, but now there's attention because the damage happened in a mass. If it was a Muslim community that was bombed, Manila would not give this much attention. I've heard that also from some experts.
Which is a reasonable observation.
So
For
by
one,
targeting a Catholic a mass, you have Manila's attention. You have Malacañang's attention. But it may not really be to sow division among the faiths. That's what one expert told me. What are your thoughts? Because the Marawi situation is dire. They're neglected.
yeah, I think on one hand, and we've raised this several times, even earlier, that the rehabilitation of Marawi is essential to sustain yung victory in 2017 that we've declared. And if this one gets delayed, the people who laid siege on Marawi in 27 will have reason to say, you look, government does not care about you.
Government has forgotten us.
Yes, and that all along we've been correct in saying that we need to fight this government because this government does not care about Muslims. So which is why it is really imperative that we quickly rehabilitate Marawi, allow its people to rebuild the city. A government should really quickly deliver on the commitments. Yun ang importante. And we've communicated that several times already. So it's still part of the overall design of the violent extremist groups to portray a situation where it can justify its actions, that government does not care and that it only cares if it is threatened. And therefore, the means of achieving our goal is really violence. So they don't believe in negotiated settlements, in peace processes. They always they've been saying that the MILF, for instance, succumbed to government and a sellout because it did not insist on fighting government so it can defeat government and establish a state which would be governed by religious laws. So that is still the consistent narrative.
Well, I wanted to ask you, sir, because you clearly have major influence in the region. What failed with the rehabilitation? There were billions of pesos that were set aside for Marawi. There's a coliseum there that's empty. There's an auditorium that's massive. It's gargantuan, it's empty, which people don't need, frankly, an auditorium right now, right? They're building a school, but there are no residents there. You have in other areas successfully relocation, homes that have been built. And yet Marawi, 6 years after, their homes are still riddled with bullets. They have not moved back to their homes. They have no money to spend to rebuild their homes. Pero government had so much money. They were able to build. So what went wrong?
I think several factors. One was that the design of the task force in Marawi to rehabilitate the city was flawed from the very start because the budget for the task force was large in different departments of the national government. So the head of the task force would have to talk to individual departments so that the budget may be used for some of the projects already identified. So you can just imagine the difficulty of coordinating all and every departments who holds the fund. So even if you want it quick, you still have to deal with the bureaucracy of government. So we've been saying from the start, we should probably look at other agencies created in some other jurisdictions where you have a solid task force that carries the bureaucracy needed as well as the funds needed to do the projects quickly. Second, I think there was also, in terms of sequence and priority, we prioritize major infrastructures. We've not taken a closer look at the people. The plan should have been centered around people, not so much infrastructures. While the infrastructures are important, I think these infrastructures are supposed to support the return of the people and their lives in Marawi. So we've not been very serious about creating a people-centered plan for the rehabilitation. So I think this lesson should really be examined very closely and quickly we should make the necessary adjustments.
Yeah, because when people are oppressed, when they feel oppressed rather, and they're frustrated, you may kill the combatant, as they say, but you won't kill the cause, right?
Yeah, it's yes. Very true. And if even if you have a very small group, you can inflict maximum damage by carefully selecting the targets.
Yes. And the difference here would be economics. A good economy, livelihood, I mean, a flourishing Marawi would have made all the difference.
Yes, and there's a very unique culture in Marawi. And in before the devastation in 2017, you have a strip there, a street where people converge to drink coffee, where everyone talks about. And that place has always been the place for creating connections among people and in a way heals the whole of Lanao and Marawi. And this is Banggulo. I've been to that place many times, and it's a place for connecting with people. It's a place for building social cohesion. We've lost that, and there's no way you can artificially create a space for people to talk and converse. So
Okay,
I think
agree.
these are things we lost.
Yes, okay, because right now in Mindanao State University, of course, it's well secured, it's heavily secured right now, but then it doesn't guarantee another attack elsewhere, right? That's the
Very true.
problem.
Very true. And which is why it is important to invest in a community-based program for countering violent extremism, because the security sector cannot be present in every inch of the territory. It is really about creating amongst people an awareness that we need to fight violent extremism, and that this is not good, that this is not inherent in our culture, and that we should take the lead as a people to counter and fight violent extremism. Until we achieve that, it would be very difficult to guarantee security in every inch of the territory.
I'm curious, this may be a far-off question, but then there in the realm of possibilities in the world today, it seems anything is possible. They are attributing this terror attack to ISIS, right? To ISIL. Are you seeing some form of inspiration or connection with the fact that Hamas attacked Israel? I mean, it was also a day that Israel didn't expect it. I mean, you had Gaza, that was occupied, but at the end of the day, you do have the Palestinian people fighting for self-determination for many years. And with what's ongoing in that side of the world, do you see a possible connection there? Do you feel that it gave bravado to these perpetrators? Because to a degree, Marawi's been quiet for a while.
That's true. And since 2017, we've practically decimated the ranks of the ISIS locally. Even the foreign nationals who were at one point in Mindanao are no longer here. I think the connection may not be there between what's happening in Gaza and what happened in Marawi. The good thing is that in the case of the Philippines, we've not presented a target for violent extremists linked to international groups. Simply because we've taken a position na neutral in the current war in Gaza. And therefore, the government has not taken the position of justifying Israeli actions or what's happening in Gaza. And therefore, local terror groups are not interested in targeting government to link it to what's happening in Gaza, which is good. And we've been urging government to take a cautious position in the war in Gaza, so we don't give reason for local terrorists to seek funding from international terror group so that it can perpetrate bigger attacks even in the country. So we have to watch that very carefully also, because the potential is always there. In 2017, they made that connection, funding came in, and so they were able to launch a bigger attack.
Okay, that's very good point, sir. So my last question is, you have 10.1 or 2 billion pesos in confidential and intelligence funds in the 2024 budget. This year alone, there were billions of funding for intelligence funds that went to different agencies, some of them civilian agencies this year. And yet, no less than Senator Bato de la Rosa cited that this is a failure of intelligence, right? What happened is a failure of intelligence. So let's talk about the relation now. We're all struck with the fact that it proves where we should put intelligence funds.
So my sense is that we really need to take a look at the lay of the ground in Mindanao. So we are slowly defeating in major ways the violent extremist group. In Sulu, for instance, we practically eliminated the Abu Sayyaf group. We are building roads. We are providing housing for former ASG members. We are supporting them so that we can finally transition from conflict to development. And in Sulu, you'd be surprised, you can actually go around Sulu even at nighttime. Before, even with military convoy, it's difficult to go around Sulu. Now we've transformed that. Marawi and Cotabato City, the Narciso Highway, used to be a road that nobody wants to cross. But today, you have public transport playing that role. From Papagayan all the way to Cotabato City and to General Santos City, even on the nighttime. So there has been transformation in the region. We need to sustain this by looking at really supporting livelihood, job opportunities, creating economic activities in the different areas of the region. So we really have to support these things. We also need to a communication strategy that looks at the details of the ongoing transformation in the region so we can communicate that. Because, for instance, the reaction from some of our colleagues in the development world is really negative after the bombing. For instance, the Transcentral Road for Marawi City, which is funded by the ADB, there are discussions among our colleagues in the development world that they will suspend the implementation of this major infrastructure, which is important for Marawi and for the constituents of the Lanao region. So I think the part of the spending of government should look at other priorities other than supporting intelligence work. While intelligence works are important, it is also important that this is linked to not just preventing attacks of this type, but also making sure that people feel development are happening and that they now have a future. Because that's the only guarantee that people will care about their people's lives and their communities, that they have a future. If you don't see a future which is good for you and for your children, it's easy for you to succumb to the ideology of violence.
On that note, I want to thank you so much, Bangsamoro Interior Minister Naguib Sinarimbo, for joining me today. I do hope to speak with you again, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Pleasure always.